Yeah.
Thank you. So I think we could just start and say a warm welcome to our first speaker. That's Per Nielsen, who is a Danish historian who's been working in the National Museum of Denmark, a curator who has been teaching at the University of Copenhagen, who's recently done an exhibition at the National Prison Museum in Horsens, which I think you maybe all should go and see. Is it open yet? Or it is. So you, it's in Jutland, but if you pass by. And that's an exhibition about West Indian prisoners in Danish prisons. So that might be very interesting. And well, he was actually also the first teacher I had who taught Caribbean history. So that is really something. Yeah.
Good afternoon. I'm happy to see all of you here. Some people have traveled very far to be here today. That's wonderful. Thank you so much. Over the years, when I have been in the US Virgin Islands, I have noticed that I get questions about the status of the Danish West Indians back in the Danish colonial era. People will come to me and ask, were people in these islands Danish citizens? Were black people in the islands actually Danish citizens? Now, this may not as much be out of interest in history as a matter of working with the identity as a part of the United States today, to understand the background of entering the United States in 1917, and therefore finding out what were actually our status before transfer. But anyway, therefore, it seems that this question is relevant to people in the islands. I have also, in the same period, seen that a lot of people in Denmark, when I speak different places, will not think that the people in the islands were Danish citizens. If I ask an audience if the people who descended from Africa were Danish citizens by 1917, almost everybody will say, oh no, it couldn't be. And there will be some little old lady in the corner who would say, oh yes, I'm quite sure that people were Danish citizens. And I say, why do you say that? And I say, oh, well, they were born on Danish land. And the rest of them will say, no, you know, if they were citizens, we couldn't have sold the islands. Very interesting. So isn't this quite some questions we are working with here? Something that could be relevant in the Virgin Islands as well as in Denmark. I therefore decided to make citizenship the topic for 2017 for myself. And the question today is, were the native-born inhabitants of the Danish West Indies Danish citizens? And if so, was the citizenship actually respected by the Danish authorities? So this is what we are going to be working with. I will be quite a bit of the time talking about Danish laws of citizenship. I will also try to place the Danish West Indies politically in the Kingdom of Denmark. And I will point out a few places where people are concerned about citizenship during the Danish era. And then I will mention a few cases that I have run into where people's citizenship is in question in Denmark up to 1917. I will look at what the treaty between the United States and Denmark of 1916 says, and I'll show to you one example of a Danish West Indian who arrives here after 1917 to see what happens to that person. So, by then you deserve an answer. But don't worry. So, the focus is on the people of African background. Now, that really may make no sense to point that out. But since this is what people in the islands and people in Denmark are concerned about, I want to focus on that. And it is would make sense here at the beginning to try to look at what does the Danish literature say about this question. Well, see, the fact is that I have, in the 30 years I've been interested in the Danish West Indian history, I have not really been concerned about this, because if you read the history books here, it's quite clear that the Danish West Indians were Danish citizens. That's what the old works, the Vore Gamle Tropekolonier from the early 1950s says. That's what Professor Hornby's book from 1980 says. And believe it or not, that is what the latest Danish West Indian history book, edited by Mr. Olsen himself, sitting right here in front of us, says. So these three main histories of the Danish West Indies that are published in Danish think that the Danish West Indians were citizens. Well, I just want to point out to one book that may be unknown to some of you. Professor of Law Vagn Greve, the late Professor of Law Vagn Greve, published his book on Danish colonial penal law back in 2012. That I thought would be quite interesting to dig into and see what does a lawyer say about this matter. And I was so happy to find that he pointed out very clearly, native-born Danish West Indians were Danish citizens. Well, shouldn't we all just go back home? You got the answer already. Okay. There's no more to say. Well, I'll try to build up the story anyway, since we're here. And what would be the sources? Well, the archives here there, where we are sitting naturally holds bunches of wonderful stuff to try to document these questions, and the National Archives in Washington as well, but also the Parliamentary Commission reports that we have from 1879, that from 1903, and that from 1916. They are all of interest, and then the treaty between the two countries. So, as a beginning, Danish laws of citizenship. The law of birthright citizenship of 1776. So it's so nice with that year, because it's so easy when you learn history. There's so many things took place. The very year when Adam Smith published The Wealth of Nations, the very year when the Greenlandic Trade Company was established, which is still working this very day, and all these wonderful things that happened, something on the other side of the ocean took place too, I've heard, and the law of birthright citizenship. And you see that on this little figurine at the right. It's from the Royal Copenhagen Porcelain Factory. And isn't it going to be exciting to find out who these three children are? This is the mother state, but who are the kids? Will we find a Danish West Indian? Da-da-da-da. They're the Danes. They're the Norwegians. And the Holsteiners. No Danish West Indians. Sorry about that. So our last chance is, who were the Danes? Maybe we could find them here. I will try to dig into three different examples of groups of peoples in the Virgin Islands to try to answer the situation around 1776. See, when the law came in 1776, foreigners would come in with application to be naturalized as Danish citizens. From St. Croix came that very year two applications. One was brought in hand by a certain Christopher McAvoy Sr. from St. Croix. He and his wife and the kids sailed the ocean and came into Copenhagen, handed in the application, bought themselves a huge residence around the corner from here and a little weekend place north of town. And certainly everybody could see that these were people with money. But what is interesting is that these two applications came from people who were born outside the Danish West Indies. They were both British subjects. So all the plantation owners in St. Croix, whether they have British or Dutch or French names, the Armstrongs, the Burkes, the Heiligers, the De Vents, none of them applied. They were already citizens. And it says in the law that the people of St. Croix, of the Danish West Indies, were citizens. Well, that's probably just the rich people, don't you think? Let's look at another group. This person, John Brutus, he was born in St. Croix and he lived in Copenhagen for many, many years. He was a sailor, and he was, because he was a sailor, enrolled in the Royal Navy and had to stand up for the king when it was time for war and whatever. And he, a couple of times, wrote the king and the crown prince concerning different matters. He presents himself something like this: "I am a Negro and a native of St. Croix, His Majesty's subject." Well, so he calls himself a subject, the old-fashioned word for something kind of like a citizen. But now that's what he himself says. Maybe that doesn't mean that he's a citizen. But on the other hand, he was a free man. Why shouldn't he be a citizen if Christopher McAvoy could become a citizen? All the Armstrongs and the Heiligers and the De Vents were citizens. I see no reason not to believe that he was considered Danish. But let's go on with that question later. And then, the third group, what about the enslaved people in the islands? What would their situation be concerning the law? Well, laws of citizenship is one thing. But what about laws of private property? That is serious business, I tell you. Private property, you don't fool with that. And I cannot give you a clear answer, but I wouldn't be surprised that private property is stronger than a little simple citizenship. Meaning that most likely they were not included. But what is interesting is that a lot of things happen after 1776. The private property is certainly not what it used to be when, as the years go by. First, very interesting thing is that we get the abolition law, the abolition of the transatlantic slave trade in 1792. And what does that mean? Well, that means that 10 years later, it's illegal to bring in more Africans. Oh yes, there were some smuggling, etc. But day by day, more and more of the enslaved people were locally born in the islands. Year by year, they were native born. Year by year, new regulations came that gave them the right to stand up in court and to bring in a case, even go to school. So that property isn't what it used to be. But then we surely are waiting for the final change. But before I get to that, I will say there is a little date here that should help us with group number two. In 1834 comes the law of equal rights, that all free people in the Danish West Indies are equal. So by then, at least we could say that the free, so-called free colored people are citizens. I believe they were before, but if not before, then at least here. And then it is quite clear that by 48, we'll have all local born people being citizens. So, okay, by 1848 at the last, citizens. Now, the thing about the Danish state is that you have different parts of the state. Back in 1776, there were the two kingdoms, Denmark and Norway, the Duchies, Schleswig-Holstein, and then later on comes Oldenburg, etc., and we have Greenland, Iceland, the Faroe Islands, and the Danish West Indies. It's all very confusing. There can be different laws, but it's still one state. And when it comes to the birthright citizenship law, it was the same in Denmark and in the Danish West Indies. The next law that makes a few changes is the law of citizenship of losing and gaining citizen rights back in 1898, saying that all native-born who have lived within the state of Denmark until the age of 18 have the right to Danish citizenship. What does that mean? That means that if two people, it could be field workers from Barbados, moves to St. Thomas, or to St. Croix most likely, their kids grow up in St. Croix, and by the time that they turn 19, they have the right to be Danes. If they claim British or French or Dutch citizenship, that's it. But if they don't claim a foreign citizenship, then they are considered Danish citizens. So that's kind of the only important change in that law. As far as the relationship between the Danish West Indies and the kingdom, let us look upon what happens with the Constitution of 1849. That's when the absolute monarchy ends, and the constitutional monarchy begins. So we still have that one state with various parts, which I mentioned before. But they're quite different. They're very different, culturally different, historically different, speak different languages. Danish, Dutch, Icelandic, Faroe, Icelandic, Greenlandic, and believe it or not, English and Dutch, Creole Dutch. All kinds of languages are spoken in the Danish state. They have different laws, but they're one state. So the Danish West Indies, what about the islands when the Constitution came? Should they be represented in Parliament? See, the first Prime Minister actually imagined that they should be represented in Parliament. If that had been the case, I guess we could say that it would be an official change in the way that the islands would be becoming an official part of the kingdom, the old idea of the kingdom. But before doing this, the Prime Minister sent a statement to the governor in the West Indies, and he answered, "Oh, no way, no way." These people, right after emancipation, and they speak all kinds of funny languages, and oh, no, no, no. So nothing came out of it. So what happened? What happened was just that it continued like what was quite common in the Danish state, different laws, different places. So there were certain political systems in the kingdom and other systems in the Danish West Indies, like different colonial laws, and they are renewed in 1863. And you see some of the historians actually talking about sort of a constitution of the Danish West Indies, where finally most of the local political institution is set up. So then I promised you to look at some of the times where you have in question whether the people in the Virgin Islands, in the Danish West Indies, were actually citizens. And after the labor revolt in 1778, a parliamentary commission was established to travel to the islands and to come up with a statements about what to do in the islands. And what is clear in that report is that they do consider the people in the islands as Danish citizens. There's no doubt about that. They have different history and they have all kinds of explanations of what are the reasons for what happened, etc., etc., but they still look upon people, black or white, as citizens. And the same is the case in 1903, and that is following the second agreement between the Denmark and the United States to transfer the islands. It was accepted in Washington, but it was not accepted in Copenhagen. The upper house here didn't approve of the treaty, and therefore everything was back to normal. And then a parliamentary commission was sent out to the islands. Groups of people in the islands were asked to come up with suggestions of what reforms were needed in the islands. And one of the groups that come in with suggestions and questions asked directly, are we citizens? And in the report, the answer is yes. I have looked at some cases in connection with my latest book about Mrs. Jensen and other Danish West Indian people who were living in Denmark, and to see how the citizenship, how the question about citizenship is dealt with in Denmark. Now, citizenship in a lot of ways is something that you really test when you leave your home place. What happens if a St. Thomas sailor gets stuck in Shanghai or in New York? Where will he go to find help? Well, he will go to the Danish consulate. In all the cases I have seen, he'll get help. He'll be taken back to St. Thomas. Just like if he came from Copenhagen, he would be taken back to Copenhagen. So that system works. And I have looked into some cases, what happens when they are here. We have, for example, Anne Adams of St. John, who as a nanny came to Copenhagen with a family and works here as a nanny and a tutor and ended up living here for 29 years. She died in a Copenhagen suburb in 1912. Well, when she couldn't work any longer, she received her old age pension, like everybody else. There seems to be no question about whether she was had the right to live here and to receive public welfare. And then Mrs. Jensen, that I mentioned before, she came before she married. Henriette Jacobs was her name, from St. Croix. And she decided to, now hold on, she decided to move to Denmark. She decided to immigrate to Denmark. She wanted to get married to Mr. Jensen someday when he went to Denmark. But he was in the army, and that would be a few years before he went back to Denmark. So she simply moved across the ocean. She found herself a job as a nanny, worked for the family on the boat, and a few weeks after they arrived, and then she moved out on her own, found herself a cleaning job in the city, and found herself a place to live, and made a living here. And 2.5 years later, Mr. Jensen arrived and they got married. So that was actually possible. You could move to the mother country. After getting married, her status naturally was different. In those days, it was the citizenship of your husband that was important. So if not before, she was a good citizen when she was married. Unfortunately, she got divorced, but she managed the rest of her life and died in Copenhagen in 1945. James Thompson, a completely different story. He turns up in the files in Copenhagen as a sailor about the age of 17 and goes on sailing out from Copenhagen on Danish ships, most of the time on the ocean-going immigrant ships to New York. And he returns to Copenhagen every so often and finally decides to change his means of living, and he gets a training as a waiter, and it turns out that that is just his field. He gets into restaurants and he becomes the head of the restaurant within no time, no matter where he is, and then he becomes a hotel owner in the city of Aarhus in Western Denmark. Now, much can be said about Mr. Thompson, but he certainly proves that somebody could settle here and become a businessman. If he had the talents for that, that was a possibility. In 1920, there was some discussion in the city council in Aarhus where the mayor points out to his fellow members of the city council that Mr. Thompson is a citizen and a native of St. Croix. So after transfer, we still take that as granted. He is one of us. Joseph Brown, young, left the islands as a stowaway, lived as a sailor, a driver, all kinds of things, lived in Germany for years, and then came First World War. What do? You go to the consulate. So he went to the consulate in Berlin and presented himself. I'm sure he didn't speak a word of Danish, but English and some German, and told that he was a good Dane. He was from St. Croix, and he needed help to get out before the war broke out. And they sent him off to Hamburg, and in Hamburg they shift him up to Copenhagen to have the Ministry of Finance, where the colonial office was, take care of business. So he came to the building next door here, presented himself as a Dane who needed help, and they talked to him. And in that situation, you would need to clear out, is this man a Dane? And in this case, I mean, you stand here with this black man who claims that he's from St. Croix, who comes in from Germany, and who has no papers whatsoever. No passport, no identification papers or anything. But anyway, before the day is over, he has a piece of paper in his hand that says that he is a Danish citizen, that he is a native of St. Croix, and it is written in the protocol that we will try to help him back to his home island. If somebody came in here from Aarhus or from Skagen or from Næstved or wherever, St. Thomas or St. Croix, they would all have the right to be taken back to where they came from. And this man was from St. Croix, so okay, that's where we sent him. But Mr. Brown, as he tells in an article many, many years later to a newspaper here, I didn't want to go home. I didn't leave home to be sent back. So he found himself a job. And he moved on in life and was here for about 64 years, working in Stockholm, in Berlin, in Hamburg, in Paris, but always returning to Denmark. And when Second World War broke out, he went to the embassy in Paris and they would help him back home to Copenhagen. So, another proof. Anyway, let's see. We have a different case here. More very interesting case. Mr. Smith, he was a field worker in St. Croix. He killed his girlfriend. He killed his former girlfriend in front of the eyes of her grandmother. There's nothing nice to be said about it. He was sentenced for murder. He escaped prison in St. Croix and lived in Puerto Rico and Baltimore for some time. And in 1908, somebody turned him in and he was brought back to St. Croix and then to Denmark. So he was in prison here for almost 15 years. That's a very long time. You would normally have been released before that. And by 1917, the prison authorities start to consider whether it's time to have him released. Maybe they should have thought about that a few months earlier. It was in May or June of 17. But by this time, things turned out to be quite difficult. Negotiations started with the United States, and the Americans said that he was not an American. He had not been in the islands on transfer, and therefore was not an American. The Danes didn't know what to do about him, but they certainly did not picture that a black man could be integrated in the Danish society. Finally, in 1923, he was released on parole that he left the country. Now, what is that? That actually means that his citizenship was taken away from him. That's as simple as it is. And it was an administrative thing. It was not something he was sentenced to. It was just something that happened in the Ministry of Law. So he forms a different example. In Article 6 of the treaty between the United States and Denmark, it says that all Danish citizens in the islands who desire to remain Danish should register as such within 1 year from the exchange of ratifications of the treaty. Okay, so you could remain Danish. All Danish citizens who are residents of the islands and who have not registered as Danish have accepted citizenship in the United States. Now, that was not quite what happened, as some of you will know, but that's what it says. So anyway, it doesn't say that the people were Danes, all of them, no matter what. But it deals with the fact that most people were citizens. I have one example after 17. I found several people who come here for the first time after transfer. The latest I have seen is in 1935, when Mr. Francis Hirsch, a master tailor in Hamburg, moves up to Copenhagen. You can all picture why he did that with the politics in Germany in the 1930s. I don't think Mr. Hirsch had ever been to Denmark. He was from St. Thomas, and he had lived for many, many years in Hamburg, and therefore he had not been in the islands at transfer. And his German wife had married a Dane, a Santomian Dane, and therefore she had become Danish. And therefore they moved to Copenhagen, and they from day one had the rights to vote at national elections. They had public health and public pension. So the citizenship still worked after that many years. We run through these different topics, which all seem to prove what the history book says. And it will be no surprise to you that I say that, yes, the answer to the question is the native-born Danish West Indians, no matter their geographic background, were Danish citizens. And the examples that I have looked at show that it was respected in all but one case. There was a murderer, where it was not respected, but for all the others. Thank you very much.
an interesting presentation. So are there any questions? I have one, of course. So I was wondering, the question is then, is it that one case where it's not respected that is actually most important? Because it's easier to respect something or when there's no difficulties, but could have been done if it was a murderer who was born in Jutland?
Exactly. It is an interesting question. And the fact that you actually did send people out of the country when they were released, up until around 1900, you would send certain prisoners out of the country when they were released. You would buy them a ticket to the United States to get rid of them. But believe it or not, then the United States set up this funny place, Ellis Island, to screen the immigrants. And that made it more difficult. But don't worry, we managed to sneak in a few now and then. And naturally, they were white, all of them. So in that case, you come up with an interesting question. And therefore, I don't think this one case changes anything with the fact that people, that native-born free people were citizens. Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you for your talk. I really enjoyed it, and it's something that we can't help but think about, the idea of the citizenship. And I've come across it in my work with the Herald and David Hamilton Jackson. And so I want to ask you, because you sort of went really quickly when you said when something happened when they became American, the islands became American, and so the citizens, everyone born in the islands, were supposedly citizens. And they were supposedly American citizens after transfer. However, that didn't happen. Could you elaborate a little bit on that? What happened, and why was it that they then were not American citizens?
I think the Danes were either naive or thought it was okay, or gave in on something that we don't know about. The Danes had it as a declared idea that people should become citizens from day one, but the Danes also had it as an idea that they should vote about it in the islands, which was not because they cared about what people said in the islands, because everybody knew that there would be a majority who wanted the transfer. No, the whole idea was to come up with a principle which was to be used against the Germans concerning Northern Schleswig. The whole idea of hoping to have the Schleswigians vote themselves back to the kingdom. So the Danes had to give in here and there, and I would imagine they had to give in here too. And it's just written in the treaty in the way that it looks okay. And they were accepted as legal residents in the United States, but then after 10 years comes the more official change where people have citizenship. But it has a lot of interesting aspects in the way that you can imagine that people who had gone to New York, for example, 10 years before transfer, they were not in the islands. So they were still Danes. They still had to apply for American citizenship. So in that way, a lot of funny things came out of at that time. But you do see people in the islands who go to the authorities and register as Danes in the days around transfer. Most of them are naturally people who had come out from Denmark and who want to make sure that they can go back to Denmark. But there are also people of African background in the islands who sign up as Danes after transfer. Now, I don't know if they just had read the American newspapers and knew how life was in the United States in certain parts or what it was, But some of these families must have been concerned, and you can see it when you look in the first census. You can see families in the first census that are registered as Danes, and some of them are registered as undecided, because that first census came around New Year 18, within that year. So some of them had not decided yet. So they used that whole year to wait and see.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. And thank you so much, Mr. Nielsen, for the great presentation this afternoon and all the wonderful pictures of our people. My question comes because when my grandmother passed, we had no identification of her during the Danish West Indian time. All that we could find was a little piece of paper, very ragged, that said, witness, Rose Mahoney, born in the Danish West Indies. Were they ever presented with identifications of citizenship? Was that citizenship in Denmark itself ever presented to the people of the Virgin Islands so that they could have identification? Because that never happened to my grandmother.
People, no matter where it was within the state, didn't have identification. It was not like today. If you didn't need to identify yourself, if you lived in outside of Copenhagen, somewhere in the countryside, or if you lived in St. Croix, somewhere in the countryside, you didn't need to identify yourself. You were just Peter Armstrong or Peter Hansen or whoever. But if you suddenly wanted to go out of the island, then you would need the papers. And then the authorities would say, okay, where were you born? Well, I was born in that estate, and I was baptized in the Anglican Church. And they say, well, bring in your baptism certificate. And when you have that one, we can see you are a native, you are a Dane. So when she had her birth information, that would be the proof that she was a Danish citizen. When the West Indians that I showed pictures of here turn up here, like the stowaway Brown who came in from Germany, he needed identification because he had to travel across the Atlantic. And then he got, they called it a homestead paper, but it actually clears out, where were you born? Who's going to pay for you if something happens to you? And who's going to pay is your local community. Whether it be in Denmark, Iceland, the West Indies, the local community, and that may be the St. Croix community, the St. Thomas community, who will have to pay to bring you home. So she probably didn't have documentation because she didn't need it. But if suddenly she traveled up to New York, then you have her in the files, and it says that she, her name, her age, and then we get African nationality, Danish, or it says black and Danish, or it says West Indian and Danish. When it says West Indian, you kind of never know what this means. But there you get that Danish.
Thank you very much for a wonderful presentation. It was very interesting. The question has been growing in me, and now you've documented very well that the people that were born in the Danish West Indies were Danish citizens. So the question that has now words is, how was it then possible to sell the Danish West Indies?
Exactly.
And was there any precedence for this? Has it ever happened since? Is this a unique event?
What is interesting is that, as I mentioned at the beginning, that people today usually don't imagine here that the people in the islands were citizens. I can tell you that I have looked at the censuses around transfer, And out of the 26,000 people in the islands around transfer, it seems that about 21,000 were Danish citizens. The rest of them were mostly down island people, and some of them from the States and different other European countries, etc. But about 20 to 21,000 people were Danish citizens. So they went right along. Now, we cannot say that they were sold. There was no ownership to these people. They could have moved away, but the territory where they lived was sold, and so naturally they went along. I don't know what happened when the United States bought Alaska from Russia a few years earlier, and when these kind of things happen different places in the world, that you transfer places. It's usually something that happens during war. And when concerning the borderlands between Denmark and Germany, it's also the war situation until the decision in 1920, where you have the vote, where people vote for whether they want to be Danish or German. That's quite an unusual way of solving such a situation. And you could have imagined you could have done that in 1917, and there's no doubt that people in the Virgin Islands would have said, yes, we want to be transferred. By then, they had been for sale for 50 years, and they had given up. But in 1902, you still could see demonstrations where people were pro-Danish. They would go into the streets in red and white clothes to demonstrate for remaining Danish. So they still had some hope. But by 1916-17, that hope was gone. So I guess the fact that everybody knew in the islands and here that the people in the islands want to be American, then it was over with. But the fact that you sell territory with some of your own citizens is quite interesting. And I usually, when I go out and speak here, I say to people, well, maybe we're going to sell your community next time. I was up speaking up in Gentofte, and you know, that's where they've got a little money here and there. So I say, oh, maybe this is going to be the community we'll sell, because that will pay well.
Could I just add one small question to that? Because I'm considering that Denmark actually had two colonial areas, namely in India and in West Africa, which were settlements sort of rented or from local authorities. And I'm wondering what happened there. Does anybody actually know?
As you said yourself, they were rented.
Yeah.
And that already makes a difference. And as you know, in Africa, the ones we were concerned about were those who descended from a Dane or a Norwegian. If they were mulattoes, then we were concerned. But because then they had a Christian father.
And could they keep some Danish citizenship? I'm just wondering if anybody had actually looked at that. And in Trangabad, there was quite a large piece of land. So some people must have been, maybe, I don't know. Well, anyway, that's just a thought. There are two more questions, and then please make it short. And then we'll have coffee.
Oh, actually, it is not a question. I think it's a kind of comment to Anna Monica's question. I think what is important here is to differentiate between citizenship and constitutional rights. And what the Danish West Indians didn't have were Danish constitutional rights. And this is part of the answer, I guess, to why they were not asked. Because they didn't have constitutional rights the same way as Danish citizens in Denmark.
It certainly depends on what you call constitutional rights.
And it all boils down to that the Danish West Indies was a colony. And a colony, you, when you're a state and a government, you think about in a different way than your home territory citizens. That's just a comment.
I'm not quite sure that I agree with you that the Danish West Indies was a colony by 1917. We'll take up that discussion some other day. But things had certainly changed so much in the Danish West Indies that it was a part of Western society that we are dealing with. But anyway, the Stanford encyclopedia concerning citizenship talks about the legal dimensions, which is very much what I've been talking about here, the political dimensions, which could be, for example, the fact that there are different laws, different places, different political institutions, different places, etc. And then the matter of identity, which I didn't touch very much, except we have talked a lot about it now. So yes, there are a lot of different aspects of it, but I would say that the legal aspect is also a part of the constitutional definition of citizenship.
And then one last short question. And
thank you very much. Your introductory statement made it look as if the Danish government had the option to sell or not to sell. My limited understanding on this matter tells me that the Danish government was forced to sell. Is that true?
I don't believe so. There were people in this country, there were people in Denmark that used that as an argument during the discussions whether to transfer the islands or not. But why the United States should force Denmark to sell these islands, as you all know, the United States were only interested in St. Thomas. They could care less about St. Croix and St. John. But they didn't want somebody else to come in. And as we could see during Second World War, United States went in and into Iceland and to Greenland during the war, but not to take over the areas. And I'm not quite sure that United States was interested in the islands. They were just interested in avoiding a foreign power coming in. That's my understanding.
That was a really good closing remark. So thank you so much.